Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear. The hour I first
how afternoon and welcome to the Christian funeral service of Dick Hanel, Richard. Dick, we call him Dick. Yeah. And we're glad you joined us today. We're also on live stream right now, so it's actively recording over our website, and you can pick that up whenever if you want to rewatch it. So God bless your worship today and comfort for you in the resurrection of Jesus. The worship service is printed out for you in the worship folder, and you'll see everything up on the screens, including the songs that we'll sing this morning. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, death has been swallowed up in victory. Thanks be to God. When Christ, who is our life, appears, we will be before the throne of God. Never again will we hunger, for the Lamb at the center of the throne will be our shepherd. He will lead us to springs of living water. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus, you wept at the grave of your friend Lazarus, and you consoled Mary and Martha in their distress. Draw near to us who mourn for our loved one now fallen asleep, and dry the tears of all who weep. Calm our troubled hearts, dispel our doubts and fears, and lead us to praise you for having brought Dick to faith. In your rising from the dead, you conquered death and opened the gates to eternal life. Strengthen us with your word and lead us through this earthly life until at last we are reunited with you and all the saints in glory everlasting. We pray in your name, O Savior, you who live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. Please join me now in singing On Eagle's Wings. for your comfort and strengthening, a compilation of Bible passages. God created the man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him, male and female, he created them. God saw everything that he had made, and indeed it was very good. The Lord God took the man and settled him in the Garden of Eden to work it and to take care of it. The Lord God gave a command to the man. He said, "You may freely eat from every tree in the garden, but you shall not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, for on the day that you eat from it, you will certainly die, for the wages of sin is death." When the woman saw that the tree was good for food and that it was appealing to the eyes, and that the tree was desirable to make one wise, she took some of its fruit and ate it. She gave some also to her husband who was with her, and he ate it. So then just as sin entered the world through one man and death through sin, so also death spread to all people because all sinned. In fact, there is no difference, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Say to them, "As I live, declares the Lord God, I take no pleasure in the death of the wicked, but rather that the wicked turn from their way and live. Turn back from your evil ways. Why should you die? The Lord is patient for your sakes, not wanting anyone to perish, but all to come to repentance. God our Savior wants all people to be saved and to come to a knowledge of the truth. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For the wages of sin is death, but the undeserved gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. But as it is written, what no eye has seen and no ear has heard and no human mind has conceived, that is what God has prepared for those who love him. God revealed it to us through his Spirit. Jesus said, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I am going to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you to be with me so that you may also be where I am. You know where I am going, and you know the way." "Lord, we don't know where you are going," Thomas replied, "so how can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." So then, just as one trespass led to a verdict of condemnation for all people, so also one righteous verdict led to life-giving justification for all people. Indeed, if by the trespass of the one man death reigned through that one man, it is even more certain that those who receive the overflowing grace of the gift of righteousness will reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ. Jesus said to Martha, "I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me will live, even if he dies, and whoever lives and believes in me will never perish. Do you believe this? For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor rulers, neither things present nor things to come, nor powerful forces, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord." We do not want you to be uninformed about those who have fallen asleep, or to grieve in the same way as the others who have no hope. Indeed, we believe that Jesus died and rose again. Then, in the same way, we also believe that God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep in him. In fact, we tell you this by the word of the Lord. We who are alive and left until the coming of the Lord will certainly not go on ahead of those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up in the clouds together with them to meet the Lord in the air, and so we will always be with the Lord. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, because the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea no longer existed. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, adorned for her husband. And from the throne I heard a loud voice that said, "Look, God's dwelling is with people. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people. God himself will be with them, and he will be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, or sorrow, or crying, or pain, because the former things have passed away." The one who was seated on the throne said to me, "Look, I am making everything new." He also said, "Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true." Thanks be to God. He gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. And I heard a voice in heaven say, "Write, blessed are the dead who die in the Lord from now on. Yes, says the Spirit, because they will rest from their labors, for their works follow them." Thus far our scripture readings. We now join to sing "In Christ Alone." Now may the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, equip you with everything good for doing His will. And may He work in us what is pleasing in Him through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Mr. Richard Dick Donald Hanel was born on December 14, 1942 in Mankato, Minnesota, to Herbert and Leona Hanel. Dick came into the Christian faith through baptism shortly after he was born and became a child of God in that same year of 1942. He was confirmed into the Christian faith at Emmanuel Lutheran Church in 1956, and if I might add, that's the year I was born, so. He married Linda, and I'm going to get her last name right? Hufstutter. We practiced on that. On October 10th, 1964, the Lord blessed their marriage with two children, April and her husband Steve, who's here, and their son Curtis and his wife Sharon, also here today. The Lord also blessed him with grandchildren, Sydney and her husband Timothy, who wasn't able to make it, and Jack Hanel. Also with Ty and his wife Jessica Hall, and Courtney and her husband Ryan Pedigo. I asked about that. And there's four great-grandchildren. He is survived by his wife, Linda, the family I just mentioned, along with other relatives, including a sister and a sister-in-law, correct? And other relatives and friends, and also his church family here at Hope Lutheran Church. His parents, brother Jerry and sister Karen, Jerry's son is here today, and wife, they all preceded him in death. In fact, within, as most of you probably know, within a month or so before Dick. The Lord our God in His infinite grace and mercy called Dick home to heaven on December 9th, 2020 at the age of 77 years, 11 months, and 25 days, 5 days before his birthday. The text that I chose for your comfort today comes to us from the first letter of St. Peter, chapter 1, verses 3 to 6. This happens to be the last devotion text that I used the last day I saw Dick, right the day before he died. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. By His great mercy, He gave us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, into an inheritance that is undying, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you. Through faith, you are being protected by God's power for the salvation that is ready to be revealed at the end of time. Because of this, you rejoice very much, even though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been grieved by various kinds of trials. This is God's word. No one who has experienced a blessed and happy marriage and family life ever wants to say goodbye. When my grandchildren leave and my children leave from their visit, I am not a really happy person to see them go. But it's especially difficult when it's your dear husband of 56 years and a dear parent and grandparent, friend, relative. It's extremely hard to say goodbye, especially when the goodbye looks like it's going to be unending. Thankfully, it's not a final goodbye. It's only temporary. It's a goodbye for now, sure, but it won't last. We thank God for that. That's where faith comes in and why it's so vitally important. We know that we're going to see Dick again and Jerry and Karen and all the loved ones that we have, all those who believed in Jesus as their Savior, because the day of resurrection is coming. That desire, even in the face of death, is where the word hope comes from. Not hope like we have in this world. Well, I hope it doesn't snow so much tomorrow. That's not the kind of hope that the Bible talks about in its word, elpidzo. No, that word hope means something that is a reality that we just haven't experienced yet. The reality is still to come. and that's the resurrection, and life forever in heaven with all the saints of God, all of our loved ones who fell asleep and now rest in Christ. You see, it is the Savior who gave Dick a living hope and also us. And he did it by Jesus' resurrection. Now, in order to have a resurrection, you have to have a death first. We know that's the way of all mankind. Every single one of us is going to face that personally, and we have to do it alone. I talked to Dick about that. He was so worried, not about dying, because he knew where he was going, but leaving Linda behind. I told him, she's not helpless. She has kids and family. She's going to be okay. But you know how he cared. But there's hope, you see, because of a different death. And that was the death of Jesus Christ. God taking on human flesh in his incarnation at Christmas, that first Christmas, and he lived in our place as our substitute. Sometimes it would have been really great when I was back in college and post-college and seminary, where I had a test, you know, in Hebrew, and it would have been very great to have a substitute to take it so I could get a perfect mark. Now, I wasn't bad at Hebrew, but never perfect. It would have been nice to have a substitute. Well, God puts us through the test in life to see if we're going to live the way he wants us to, the way he created people to, perfectly. And I don't know about you, but I haven't found any perfect people lately, especially when I look in the mirror. As I read earlier from St. Paul, we all have fallen short of the glory of God. We've all fallen into sin. We're not perfect, but God demands that. How in the world can we get past death? We can't do it by saying, God, you have to let me into heaven because I'm perfect. No, but we have a substitute. We get to go sit on the bench, and Jesus Christ is there with his perfect life, and because he's God, it's for every one of us, and it was for Dick too. And yet, that perfect Savior had to die. Without his death, our deaths are losses. They're eternal goodbyes. But Jesus Christ lived, and that he took a perfect life and a sacrifice before God for the sins of the world. And not just for mine, not just for yours, but for everybody's. Independent of where they come from, what their traditions were, what their race was, what their culture was, what their gender is. It doesn't matter. Jesus Christ died for all. That means he died for you too. So that death, Dick's death, is not a loss. And without a death, there's no life. Because Jesus Christ rose from the dead. God guarantees through his resurrection that Dick's death is not wasted. No death in Christ is wasted. Because he lives, we also will live. God raised his son from the dead as a guarantee to us. You know, it's kind of like when you buy a new appliance, they always want to give you a guarantee. So if it busts in the first 90 days, of course, they got that plan too, I think. Because they usually break in day 92. But the guarantee that comes in Christ's resurrection is unbreakable. We will rise from the dead. And Jesus will bring us to glory. Peter put it this way. He said, by his grace, mercy, he gave us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, into an inheritance that is undying, the Greek word immortal, undefiled, there's no zits, and unfading, not like those pictures out of a Polaroid camera that were taken back in 1970. You can't make them out anymore today. But his inheritance is clear. It has no faults, no breakage. And it lasts forever. Can you find a better guarantee anywhere? And that's so oftentimes we live for the here and now instead of realizing there is a hereafter. That inheritance Dick has entered into. Can't wait to join him, actually. I don't know if there's going to be Culver's ice cream chocolate shakes in heaven, but I'm hoping so. Because I know where I'll find Dick then. Because of God's mercy, His unstoppable love, even death can't stop His grace, His mercy, and His promise of heaven. Now that comes to us through faith, Peter says in this particular text, because through faith we're connected to God. God you can't connect to because we're not on the same plane with Him, you know, different playing field, but we are connected to God by faith. Through faith, He makes us His dear children. He changes us from enemies to friends. He changes us from death to life. And we are protected by His power. Here's how Peter wrote it. Through faith, you are being protected by God's power for the salvation that is ready to be revealed at the end of time. You know, everything about Christianity is faith. We can't prove any of this stuff. I've never seen anybody rise from the dead, have you? We walk by faith, not by sight. Faith connects us to the promises of God. Faith connects us to our God Himself so that nothing can separate us from His love. Now you grieve the loss of somebody you love so dearly, and the love doesn't stop, and you really haven't lost them. You just can't talk to them right now. And so we don't grieve like the rest of people, even though at these times we are put through another test for our faith. Do we really trust that God loves us when He takes somebody so dear from us? But through faith, He gives you the power to stand up under the cross. All of us to stand up under the cross, whatever that trial might be, because He gives us faith in the resurrection of Jesus so that we can withstand the trials of life. And I don't know, some of you are a lot younger than me here. Some of you are about my age and some are a little older. And the fact of the matter is, the longer you live, the more trials you notch on the wall, you know, if you want to keep count of them. And it's interesting, too, because it seems that when I was younger, those trials seemed traumatic. And I look back now and I'm going, well, that was a baby one. You understand what I'm saying? As we get older, we just build one trial, one thing, one time of testing on top of another one. Some of the times it's our own doing and we get ourselves in trouble. You know, we do something stupid and end up in a car accident. Okay. But oftentimes it's not. God puts us through trials so that we can have His power through faith in the resurrection. And the time of death is one of the biggest trials we actually can be in life. Trials often grieve us too. Peter says, because of this you rejoice very much, even though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been grieved by various kinds of trials. Now, Peter understood what he was talking about, and he wrote to a group of believers who were living in the northern part of Asia Minor. That means modern Turkey, right up there by the seas. And they were living in the shadow of persecution. Not too much later, the whole Christian church would be under fire from the Roman government in the 90s, but this is the 60s. And Peter was getting ready to be crucified for his faith. And a lot of people could see that. The same day, they say, Paul beheaded for faith. Those were trials, weren't they, to their faith? How would you like to be painted with tar and put up on a pole and lit up so the Colosseum would have night lights to watch other Christians be eaten by lions? You talk about your trials, but I don't know if that's as difficult as losing a loved one in death. You know, we all have to go through trials at one thing or another, and they're always a trial to our faith. And if our faith is robbed from us, then there is no power of God in our lives. Then the resurrection of Jesus means nothing. There is no hope. But because Jesus lives, we know that nothing can separate us from His love, not even death, not even different kinds of trials. And through those trials, God builds our faith. And I have to tell you, I spent a lot of afternoons with Dick the last 7 months of his life because it required it. Selfishly, I enjoyed it too, you know, his pastor, but his friend as well. And that's not uncommon for me. But the talks we had as those 7 months proceeded were kind of interesting because at the beginning there was, oh, I'm going to die soon. right? And then all of a sudden the treatments were kind of working a little bit, right? The transfusions, I always got the counts when I came. That was the first thing. We always took the box scores for the week, so to speak. And the chemo worked on his week long and then off again for a few weeks, then back on. And all of a sudden it looked like maybe, just maybe, he's going to get well. Yeah? And our hopes started rising for, you know, okay, maybe this is going to go on a lot longer because we didn't expect it to go this long, right, at the beginning. And then all of a sudden it didn't work anymore. I remember the day. It didn't work anymore because God had a better and different plan for him, but a test for you all. A test, do you love me and trust me that I know what I'm doing with people that you love? And what will your answer be? If Christ is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but freely gave him up for us all, how will he not along with him freely give us all things? Because he lives, we live. Paul understood what Peter was writing here, and they were in the same city at that time in Rome. He wrote, you see, this is when he was awaiting his execution. He writes to young Timothy, I am already being poured out like a drink offering, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. From now on, there is reserved for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on that day, and not only to me, but to all who longed for his appearing. And that's why we have joy today amidst the tears. Not happiness. Happiness, like sadness, is an emotion. That comes and goes. Joy, that stays for the believer. Because joy is rooted in the living hope of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And that means we live too. I can't wait for the celebration on the last day. See all the saints. To have fun. Where no sin's involved with the fun. That's really cool. And I don't know. I hope there's Culver's in heaven. But if not, God will give us something even better. Because Jesus lives, we live. Because Jesus lived in our place, we stand before God free of sin. Because Jesus died in our place on the cross, our deaths have a future. Because Jesus lives, we will rise from the dead one day. We will live because of God's mercy, no matter what, no matter how hard our lives might be, no matter how difficult the times we live in are. Jesus gives us a living hope. Amen. Now the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will keep and guard your heart and mind in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we praise you for the great company of saints who have finished their lives in faith and now rest from their labors. We especially remember our loved one, Dick, whom you had redeemed by the blood of your Son and redeemed as your dear child through holy baptism. We thank you for giving him to us as a companion on our earthly pilgrimage. In your mercy, comfort all who are sad in this hour. We also praise you for your love in Christ, which sustains us in life and in death. In our earthly sorrows, help us find strength in the fellowship of your church with our fellow believers, forgiveness of sins through Jesus' completed work, and hope in the resurrection to eternal life. Do not leave us comfortless, but strengthen and care for us through your word and sacraments. You give us family, friends, and neighbors to help us when there is loneliness now and in the days to come. Brighten our future with a firm trust in your promises and loving care. Lord, remove our fears and make us bold to pray with confidence as our Savior taught us, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. In Job we read, I know that my Redeemer lives, and then in the end he will stand over the earth. And after my skin has been destroyed, yet in my flesh I will see God. I myself will see him with my own eyes, I and not another. How my heart yearns within me. Forasmuch as it has pleased the Almighty God and his wise providence to take out of this world to himself in heaven the soul of our departed brother, we therefore commit his ashes in the hope of the resurrection to eternal life through our Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our lowly bodies so that they will be like his glorious body by the power that enables him to bring everything under his control. May God the Father, who created this body, may God the Son, who redeemed this body together with the soul, may God the Holy Spirit, who by baptism sanctified this body to be his temple, keep these remains to the day of the resurrection of all flesh. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. So will it be in the resurrection of the dead. The body that is sown is perishable, it is raised imperishable. It is sown in dishonor, it is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness, it is raised in power. It is sown a natural body, it is raised a spiritual body. I declare to you that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Listen, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed in a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. For the perishable must clothe itself with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality. Then the saying that is written will come true, death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, he gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. And we pray. Almighty God, who by the death of your one and only Son has overcome sin and death, and who through his resurrection has restored innocence and everlasting life, in order that we should be delivered from the power of the devil, and so that our mortal bodies should be raised up from the dead on the last day, grant that with our whole heart we may confidently believe in Jesus Christ, who lived and died and rose for us. Grant that we finally, with all your saints, may participate in the joyful resurrection of those declared not guilty through faith in Jesus on that last day, through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen. We now join to sing, Lord, when your glory I shall see. Now receive with believing hearts the Lord's blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look on you with favor and grant you peace. Amen. This concludes our worship service. Are there any announcements I should make? Okay.